Hello, I'm Marco Ruscone. I'm a PhD student working on computational models to simulate tumor evolution. And in this context, I use models to simplify reality and study some specific events and behavior. So just to give a bit of context, a tumor is a microenvironmental disease, which means that there are not just cancer cells involved, but also many other cell types and substrates that are inside the tumor or that surround the tumors. And when we create computational models of cancer, then the complexity rises, the number of entities or behavior that you want to, that we need to simulate. And then the more complex my simulation becomes, the more resources I need. So, yeah, that's kind of the problem that I'm facing every day when I create those models. So how much in detail can I go to simulate a big tumor? How many cells can I include? How can I simulate a big tumor dynamics?
So hi, my name is Thalia Diniaco. I also work on multi-scale modeling, but more on the software engineer side. So I'm there to help Marco and other computational modeling scientists that want to model different biological concepts. I provide with optimizing the software they use, sometimes maintaining MPI versions and creating these versions of software that can run on high performance computing. And I also work on benchmarking some tools that we use in the PerMedCoE. I have been working alongside with biologists in this project. And I'm trying to make sure that what they run and the software that they use are optimal in terms of computation and computational resources.
So, Thalia, when you optimize a software, how do you make sure that the software still keep reproducing the same results as before? Because when you do, optimize the code, then for sure you're changing something. So how do you make sure that each new version is still compatible with the previous one?
That's a good question, actually, and it's some problem that we usually face during benchmarking some tool. But we usually have like a base model, like let's say a use case that it's very simple and that we can reproduce and see that it's actually working. But the thing is that I always enjoy having a biologist or a modeler next to me that can say that this is working good and the results are reproducible and that what I've done is actually legit, it actually works.
Okay. And do you have a minimal biological background? Because in particular, the software we're using in PerMedCoE, they aim to reproduce biological situation. So I imagine that when you are digging in the code, you need to understand which are the functions that are fundamental for reproducing certain behaviors. So maybe there are some functions that you cannot touch, and some functions that instead you can simplify more. So how do you deal in this case?
Well, I try to have a basic level of knowledge of biology. I try to maintain this knowledge in order to be sure exactly like what you said, what I am modifying, if this is important, because it has been that sometimes I thought that this function that I'm modifying that I believe is not useful. In the end, I was having problems and it was a function that was important biologically to be able to represent, to reproduce the results. So for me, it is important to, like I said earlier, it is important to have someone next to you where and have the basic knowledge first, but also be in having a communication with experts like you that I can advise and say, okay, is this correct what I'm doing, or am I actually messing up with the biology of, let's say, physicell, for example, which is something that we use a lot between us. And talking about like the knowledge that I need, that a computational person needs to benchmark, do you know how to benchmark? Have you done any training on how to do the computational part, let's say, of a benchmark and not that biological part?
So I did a very minimal, let's say, short course to learn the basic of benchmarking, but we didn't go actually into the details. I tried to learn by myself, for example, how to measure the how fast an algorithm is, and if it's too slow, what can I do to optimize it? So I can, for example, monitor the average speed of a model when I'm simulating a model, for example. But I don't know how to go into details. So I don't know which function is in my model, which function is the actual function that is slowing down the entire process. So I cannot, for example, see where are the bottlenecks in my workflow. This is something that I cannot actually see. It's quite difficult to monitor, at least for me, because I don't know how to use. I don't know if there are external software that do this, that I can just run and leave it there, and then they will give me beautiful plot saying, okay, here is the problem of your code, or if I have to add something, do some black magic with the code.
Actually, in the context of the project, we have done this this research, this analysis on the codes that we use, and it was a big part of the project in defining the bottlenecks of, let's say, Mabos, Physicell, and the different other core tools that we use. And the thing is that there are bottlenecks. There are parts of the software that run slower because they, let's say, they represent or execute a complex biological function, and that it's difficult. Okay, let's say you cannot decide not to use it because it is heavy.
Mm-hmm.
But because it is important for the software. But I think that researchers, particularly as you need to know which are the bottlenecks in your software in order to be able to decide when I should use it, or maybe the difference in my the difference in the outcome of your model, the outcome of your simulation is the same. There's no difference if you, let's say, run a particular function 100 times and if you run it 50 times, but in the resources that you will be using, in the energy, the more it's going to be executed more fast and faster, you should actually know which are these parts exactly to be able to plan on how you use this, you use your software better, I think. But is it coming to question that, is it important for you to have results quickly, efficiently, or do you prefer optimized code than a non-optimized code? Is it something that you have in mind that you take into account, let's say?
So, when I start coding for creating a simulation, I have to admit I don't immediately care for the optimized code, because first I want to make sure that the simulation is reproducing the desired result. Of course, once I make sure that the model is kind of correct, going the direction I want, then of course an optimized code is preferable. Also because when I do the models, it's not like I'm running the model once, I check the results, and then I'm happy with those results. So usually we run the models multiple times to make a statistic out of it, so which means that I have to run the code, the model 100 times for like one set of parameters. And then if I have to vary those parameters, this can escalate quickly. And also, for example, in PerMedCoE, we have some pipeline to test some drug synergies or test mutations. And those pipelines need to run to combine different mutations. And this can take, for example, can means running the model 50, hundreds of times, but even thousands of times, which for like 2D simulation is kind of fine, because usually 2D simulation takes at worst 10 minutes, but instead 3D simulation can take up to 1 hour. And then if you want to run thousands of times your models, then it means run it on the cluster for 1 week, which is not exactly preferable, let's say. So yeah, it's quite important to have the optimized code. But for example, when I run it on the cluster here in Curie, I have to admit that I don't quite care about the resources that I use. So I understand that maybe if there are two people that want to run something on the cluster and they are competing from resources, it can be a problem. But if it's just me, for example, so why should I care about the resources that I'm using in the cluster? Why can I not just use all the RAM and all the CPUs?
It would be great to do that, but there are several reasons. We can start with the climate change, with the amount of energy that we use. So when you are running something with that you, if you want to, let's say, take all of Mare Nostrum and use all Mare Nostrum tool, we're talking about big amounts of energy, and it's not very good at this time of our lives to be spending energy like that. And also, I mean, apart from the sustainability, it's also what you said, it's that we need to be more conscious about how our software runs, when we want to execute something, what is the combination of parameters that we can use that are optimal for us, but also for other people, because we don't want to be the only ones doing science. There are hundreds of other people in your institute, in my institute, that need to run their jobs. And it's important to have both the sustainable from the environment side, but also the sustainability for let's say, for science. What I wanted to ask you is how you actually feel about the researchers at the moment, not only in the scope of PerMedCoE, but how do you see biologists? Do they understand these bottlenecks, these issues that we have discussed today? How do they feel about becoming better or knowing about more computational parts of improving their work?
Yeah, so I don't think that nowadays biologists are quite aware of which are the good practice of running simulation, running models. I think that, but even me, that I'm not a biologist, but I'm a more computational biologist, I'm not aware of how to do a proper benchmarking, for example, how to optimize my code. So I think that for this, we need a better training in our formation. That's for sure. But also, it's quite important that we have some kind of chat or relations with people like you that are pure informatic people that tell us how to do our code, that correct our code, and that help us to run our models on bigger machine, which is not obvious, because we know how to run maybe on our local computer, but then when it comes optimizing the code for running on multiple nodes, that is a level of complexity that the average computational biologist, I don't think knows how to do. So, yeah.
That's true. So I think like lessons learned from the project, but also from the discussion today, is that I feel that for both of us it is important to know how to benchmark our tools. And it's something that we learned in the scope of the PerMedCoE, to know how to do how to know that your software works optimally in an optimal way, how to know that we are actually using the resources in an optimal way, or at least at the best way that we can, because obviously biology is not something that can be, let's say, implemented in a computational way very easily. It is a very complex mechanism that we are trying to simulate, no?
Yes.
So for me, it has been a lesson that I've learned inside those past 3 years in this project, that it's important to do it. It's important to do it not only for your tool, but when you're benchmarking against different tools, which is something that we have done, it is also an important procedure that you will get to know a lot about what you use and how you use it and why do you use it. How about you? How do you feel like, what do you feel that you have learned more?
Well, talking about the benchmarking of different tools, it was, I think it was pretty nice, having contact with different other modelers, because each of us has different view of how to reproduce biological behavior with the different tools, and it was also cool talking with people like you, showing us how to run faster our models. So having different view on different field was actually not only interesting but was very cool.
Yeah,